From the icy shores of Iceland to the sun-drenched beaches of the Maldives, a remarkable linguistic unity unfolds. Over 2 billion people across vast swathes of Eurasia, from the British Isles to the Himalayas, speak languages belonging to the Indo-European family. This begs a crucial question: who were the Proto-Indo-Europeans, and how did their language achieve such remarkable global reach? The 17th and 18th centuries witnessed the dawn of the Indo-European story. European scholars, struck by the similarities between European, Indian, and Iranian languages, embarked on a journey of linguistic detective work. In 1786, Sir William Jones, a polymathic British colonial official fluent in both classical European languages and Sanskrit, the ancient language of India, articulated the groundbreaking notion of a common linguistic ancestor. The term Indo-European itself, though coined by Thomas Young in 1813, had predecessors such as Indo-Germanic and Aryan in scholarly discourse prior to the mid-20th century. By the 20th century, meticulous analysis of verb conjugations, noun declensions, and sentence structures across diverse languages solidified this theory. Researchers like Jacob Grimm, better known for his fairy tales, played a vital role in reconstructing Proto-Indo-European sounds and vocabulary. Linguistic reconstruction offers a window into the lives of these ancient people. The reconstructed vocabulary suggests a hierarchical society with terms for military leaders, priests, and laborers. Evidence points to the domestication of horses, dogs, and goats, cultivation of cereals, and a familiarity with metalworking. The reconstructed language also reveals the environment they inhabited, with words for snow, oak, bears, and salmon. Pinpointing the Proto-Indo-European homeland has been a contentious issue. Early theories ranged from North Germany to North India, often influenced by nationalistic or racist agendas. Over the course of time, archaeological insights gradually accumulated, shedding more light on the enigmatic origins of the Proto-Indo-Europeans. Eventually, in the latter half of the 20th century, two prominent scientifically grounded theories emerged, each proposing distinct locales for the early Indo-European cultures. The first theory posits Asia Minor, or Anatolia, encompassing neighboring regions such as Armenia or the Balkan Peninsula, as the cradle of Proto-Indo-European world. This notion, initially suggested by the German naturalist Heinrich Friedrich Link in 1822, gained significant scholarly traction in 1987, thanks to the meticulous work of British archaeologist Colin Renfrew. Renfrew's argument drew from contemporary archaeological findings, which highlighted Asia Minor's pivotal role in the development of agriculture and the Neolithic migrations into Europe. Notably, inhabitants of this region were trailblazers in the realms of bronze metallurgy, subsequently pioneering advancements in ironworking and establishing a sophisticated monetary system based on coinage. The earliest written records of Indo-European languages, such as Hittite and Luwian, can be traced back to Asia Minor, where, during the 2nd millennium BC, the formidable Hittite Empire emerged as a rival to the established civilizations of Mesopotamia and ancient Egypt. Renfrew and his adherents contend that the Proto-Indo-European language had already taken shape during the Neolithic era. Some of its speakers remained in Asia Minor, contributing to the later formation of the Hittite Empire, while others migrated to the Lower Danube, laying the groundwork for modern Indo-European languages that would later spread throughout Europe. While this hypothesis finds favor with certain scholars, it encounters substantial skepticism and dissent within the academic community. Many linguists dispute the notion that the Proto-Indo-European language diverged as early as the Neolithic period, given the absence of domesticated horses and wheeled vehicles during that epoch. Moreover, Renfrew's theory accounts for the linguistic diffusion within Europe but fails to explain the expansive Indo-European presence in Asia, which exceeds even that of Europe. Alternatively, archaeologist Marija Gimbutas has proposed the theory of an Indo-European homeland in the western steppes of Eurasia. Following her flight from Soviet-occupied Lithuania after World War II, Gimbutas conducted extensive research in Germany, Harvard, and California. Although some of her works exhibit elements akin to social fantasy, Gimbutas adeptly juxtaposed the findings of linguists with newly discovered archaeological cultures along the lower Volga and Dnieper rivers. Subsequent revisions refined Gimbutas's theory, incorporating certain archaeological cultures into the Proto-Indo-European fold while discarding others. Since the late 20th century, genetics has become a crucial tool. While initial findings seem to offer clear-cut answers, a more nuanced picture has emerged. While haplogroups like R1a and R1b paint a broad brushstroke of Indo-European expansion, they don't provide a definitive answer to the homeland question. Proponents of both Renfrew's and Gimbutas's theories have learned to interpret them to suit their respective arguments, necessitating nearly two decades of collaborative effort and scholarly deliberation to elucidate this complex issue. What contemporary perspectives do scholars hold regarding the Indo-European origins and their earliest settlements? It appears that the prelude to Indo-European prehistory unfolded within the northern Eurasian steppes over 7,000 years ago, where northward-bound hunter-gatherers encountered their southern counterparts, likely stemming from the Caucasus or northern Iran. Their shared descendants formed the genetic bedrock of numerous contemporary populations speaking Indo-European tongues, with a minor genetic infusion from early Neolithic farmers, whose origins trace not directly to Asia Minor but to southern Europe. Over 6,000 years ago, the Proto-Indo-Europeans displayed adeptness in equine husbandry and the adoption of wheeled vehicles, catalyzing mobility of their society. Their husbandry extended beyond horses to encompass cattle, sheep, and goats. Far from mere pastoralists, representatives of the prominent Yamnaya culture, spanning 5,000 to 4,000 years ago, erected fortified settlements and engaged in riverine agriculture. Concurrently, Proto-Indo-Europeans dwelling along the Sintashta River to the east advanced metallurgical practices. Early in their narrative, Proto-Indo-Europeans exhibited proclivity for extensive migrations. Among the earliest separations were the progenitors of the Hittites and Luwians, who ventured into Asia Minor, and the Turkarians, who traversed eastward, eventually populating the Tarim Basin in western China, maintaining linguistic archaisms compared to other Indo-European branches. In the late 3rd and 2nd millennia BC, Proto-Indo-Europeans orchestrated sweeping migrations across Europe and Asia. While Marija Gimbutas posited these as aggressive invasions, climatic shifts or epidemic pressures could have motivated these dispersals from familiar terrains. These migrations gave rise to the corded ware culture in less hospitable wooded areas, and it wasn't until the middle of the 2nd millennium BC that they reached the Atlantic, resulting in significant genetic changes in regions like Britain, where there were dramatic shifts in gene pools. Eastern expansions carried Proto-Indo-Europeans to the Altai Mountains, subsequently penetrating Central Asia, northern India, and Iran. The magnitude of steppe genetic contributions varied. For instance, Mycenaean Greeks of the 2nd millennium BC exhibited genetic proportions ranging only from 9% to 17%. Of greater significance, the Indo-European genetic minority introduced their language, sparking great cultural changes throughout the southern Balkans and ultimately laying the foundation for the development of ancient Greece. As they colonized new territories, Proto-Indo-Europeans adeptly adapted to local conditions, assimilating indigenous populations, assimilating novel agricultural methodologies, and incorporating facets of local cultures. While some Indo-European groups flourished before fading into obscurity, such as the Thracians and Scythians, others forged empires and civilizations that endured. Through their global dispersion, Indo-Europeans indelibly shaped the course of world history, a narrative that may not always resonate as equitable or picturesque, but stands as our sole historical reality.
If you enjoy our short informative video, put your like and subscribe. Do not miss our upcoming videos. We may be a bit awkward, but we always manage to have a good time and find joy in the little things.